Good afternoon and welcome everyone to the 24th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2022. I'd like to welcome Edward Mountain, who is joining us this afternoon for the first time as a member of the committee. Edward is replacing Dean Lockhart. On behalf of all the members, I wish to thank Dean once again for his contribution to the work of the committee this session, and as discussed at our last meeting, I have written to Dean on behalf of the committee. As Edward Mountain is joining us for the first time today, our first item of business is to invite him to declare any relevant interests.
Thank you very much, Deputy Convener. The members of the committee will know that I've made a full declaration of my interests in the declaration of interest, but I would like to bring to your attention some key points. First of all, I am a member of a family farming partnership breeding pedigree cows and growing barley for whisky. That industry employs three people. I have an ancillary property letting business which lets cottages that used to be part of the farming enterprise and mainly consists of old farm cottages. I'm also a partner in a family fishing business, fishing for wild salmon on the River Spey, and that business also employs currently three people. I would just say to the committee, I get no financial benefit from any of the organisations that I'm a member of, but I am a member of the National Farmers Union Scotland, the Scottish Gamekeepers Association, and I am a member of the Royal Institute of Chartered Surveyors through my previous profession as a qualified surveyor. I think that's a full declaration, and committee members, I will declare any interest at any future meetings if they're relevant.
Thank you very much, Edward. So we now move to the appointment of our new convener. On the 15th of June 2021, the Parliament agreed to motion S6M00393, which resolved that members of the Scottish Conservative and Unionist Party are eligible to be chosen as convener of this committee. I understand the Conservative nominee for convener is Edward Mountain. Does the committee agree that we choose Edward Mountain as our convener?
Agreed.
Congratulations, Edward, and I will now pass over to you to convene the remainder of this meeting.
Thank you very much. Musical chairs. Hopefully I can stay in this chair for a bit. So first of all, I'd like to say thank you. I've been reading back on the committee's work in this inquiry, and I saw that you called for evidence on the 21st of November. It seems an awfully long time ago. And up until today's date, you've had 11 meetings, I think. You've received over 51 online responses and received responses from the Accounts Commission, COSLA, and various other individuals. Now, I think when I was looking back, and I will make an admission to you, I haven't read the official report for all of your meetings, but I think it was Councillor McVeigh who said in the first one that there was an elephant in the room when it came to this subject. Well, I'm going to say my elephant in the room is that reading 11 meetings worth of officials' report is a bit like a Jacob's cracker. Very tasty to start with, but it can only be done in small doses. So it will take me a bit of time to get through the official reports, and I apologise if it takes me slightly longer. But if you try reading them, you'll see why. I'm looking forward to joining the committee, who've done a huge amount of work, obviously, on this, and I'll look for their guidance and help as convener, because you've done so much more on this than I have. But we will move, therefore, to agenda item 3, which is a consideration of whether we take items 5 and 6 in private. Item 5 is the consideration of the committee's work programme, and item 6 is a discussion on the appointment of an advisor to the committee on environmental regulations and standards. Do we agree to take these items in private?
Agreed.
I think we're all agreed, so we will take items 5 and 6 in private. So we'll move on to agenda item 4, which is the evidence session, part of the inquiry into the role of local government and its cross-sectoral partners in financing and delivering a net zero. I refer members to the clerk, and Spice Papers for this item. And as I said earlier, the inquiry was launched in December to look into the progress at local level on reaching net zero targets. As I said, and I've stolen part of what I'm going to say here earlier is that there has been phase two of the inquiry, which we're at now, is looking at depth at the key themes emerging from the initial evidence sessions and the calls for views. Today we're going to start with a panel focusing on an overview of the operation of local authorities. And I welcome our two panellists who are joining us in the room today, Andrew Burns, who's a member of the Accounts Commission, and Stephen Smelly, who's Vice Convener of Unison Scotland. And I'd also like to welcome Louise Marix-Evans, who's the Director of Quantum Strategy and Technology, who's joining us remotely. Thank you, first of all, to all three of you for accepting our invitation. We're delighted to have you here in person and on the screen. Members will be asking you questions in turn, and I'd say to members it would be helpful if you could direct your questions to a specific individual. And what I would also say is to... I'm sure members don't need to know this, but to panellists, to keep your answers briefly as possible. Now, when I was convener of the previous committee, I used to wiggle my pen, which I think was a nasty habit, which I got from Christine Graham, which means that you're actually coming to the end of when I think you should be giving your answer. I've never actually had to let go of it in the person's direction, because most people have got the hint, but it's a pretty good steer for you to know when it is time for you to start wrapping up what you're saying. I, as convener, am going to take the privilege of asking the first question, and I'm going to probably ask this to you, all three of you, and I'd ask you to be brief, and I'll go to Andrew to start with, and say to you, where do you think are the biggest concerns for reducing emissions in local authorities? In which sectors are there opportunities for innovation, learning and partnership? So, Andrew, do you want to go with that, and then Stephen, and then I'll come to you, Louise, if that's all right. Andrew.
Okay, thanks very much, Convener. Congratulations on your appointment, and thanks to the committee for welcoming the Accounts Commission and inviting us to today's session. As members will be aware, the Accounts Commission holds councils and other local government bodies in Scotland to account, and we help them improve by reporting publicly on the performance. We operate, as I'm sure you all know, independently of councils and the Scottish Government. And you'll all be familiar, I'm assuming, with the better known products of the Accounts Commission, the best value reports of individual local authorities. But we also produce what are called performance audits, which are based on themes. And I'm delighted to say, just in the last 12 to 18 months, the Accounts Commission and the Auditor General for Scotland, who by chance has given evidence to another committee this afternoon, have started to look at climate change as a theme for the first time. I'm really pleased that that's happened in the last 18 months, and thus my welcome for being invited here this afternoon, Convener. Just turning to your specific questions, I mean, this may sound a little trite, but I'm going to start with it because I think it is the focus of the piece of work that we've just done, the performance audit I've just mentioned, which has been circulated to committee, Scotland Council's approach to addressing climate change. It's the first piece of work, as I've hinted at, that's been done by the Accounts Commission, looking at all 32 local authorities. I mean, I won't rehearse the main recommendations and findings just now. I'm happy to come to those when we get to further questions. But one of the key things that comes out of it is the lack of collaboration. And I don't want that to sound as a negative, because it's not meant as a negative. There's lots of really good work going on in local authorities at the Scottish Government level with partners. But if we sense from the work that we've done, if there was better, more fulsome collaboration across the levels and within the levels of government and the bodies that are responsible for reducing climate change emissions, then a greater progress could be made, which I think is really what you were getting at in your first question. If you were to press me, what single thing, you know, I'm not going to point to this emission or that emission. I think it's possibly as simple as but not as easy to crack as it sounds. Much more enhanced and effective collaboration, as I say, across and between levels of government. Hope that helps for now, Convener, but as I say, I'm happy to expand on the recommendations and the findings in the piece of work that's been circulated.
I'm interested to hear from Stephen and whether he agrees with you.
I certainly agree in collaboration is an important issue, but before we address any issue, I think, and this will be like a broken gramophone record from Unison on any question relating to local government, and that's the lack of finance that local government has, and I'll not go over all the detail. We can produce documents great length explaining the history of the underfunding of local government. But in terms of what we all hope that local government can achieve, they won't be able to achieve that unless there's proper funding. In terms of the biggest concerns, in terms of their own carbon footprint, buildings is a significant factor in that. I work for South Lanarkshire Council. The Chief Executive recently made a statement that in order to retrofit all the buildings, just the non-domestic buildings, just the schools, the swimming pools, the sports centres, the halls and all the rest of it, to bring them up to a net zero standard, would cost South Lanarkshire £500 million. South Lanarkshire, in case it's a surprise to them, doesn't have £500 million. And if you extrapolate that across the country, it comes to a bigger figure. So fundamentally, there's an issue there that needs to be addressed. I don't know if it's elephants in rooms, convener, but that's certainly one thing that can't be ignored when we talk about this. Buildings and fleet is the other area where councils themselves need to address. But there are opportunities, just by singling out those areas, there are opportunities that when they have to address the scale of that. I mean, South Lanarkshire's got some 140 schools. Some of those are some of the most modern school estate in Scotland, actually. But some of them, most of them, all of them, I think, don't match up to net zero. We continue to build buildings which will be unfit for purpose within a short space of time. So I think that's in terms of opportunity to address that. If we had sufficient funding and collaboration, as Andrew was saying, we could, within the public sector, not only start to address the retrofitting of those non-domestic buildings, but expand that because of the skills and talent that would then be brought to bear, and that then expand that into the housing, which is a major issue for retrofitting, but also within the wider community. So there are opportunities by using that. I see your pens begin to wag, convener, so I'll leave it at that at the moment.
Didn't wag my pen. I was smiling slightly when one of the official reports I read that Glasgow were estimating that the costs exceeded £1 billion to achieve that. Louise, do you want to come in? Thank you for your presentation. I understood it and it was very interesting. Do you want to make a brief opening comment on that?
Yes, thank you. Can you hear me all right?
Perfectly.
Thank you. When you asked the question about the biggest concerns and opportunities, I mean, emissions for local authorities are about two, maybe at a push, 5% of local area emissions. So that's obviously an opportunity that they've got control of. The biggest areas where that action is needed is in housing, energy efficiency and heat decarbonisation, and in transport. And those are those areas that we need where local authorities are critical, because you're bringing together infrastructure with the way people live their lives, and we have to do that at a local level that's appropriate. I think that another big opportunity and a big concern is the planning process, and the fact that we are, like the previous speaker, like Stephen just said, we're building buildings that are not aligned to net zero sufficiently. So they'll need retrofitting later. So I think if I had a magic wand, I'd be getting that planning system aligned really strongly to net zero, so that local authorities don't have to go into negotiations with developers. So all our new buildings are net zero. But the only way we can do all these things, I think, is by this collaboration or alignment through a framework of national, regional and local working. I feel like a broken record. I've been saying that for 2.5 years. And although I think your working is better in Scotland than England, and we're all really jealous of you, I think it could still, from what I hear back from authorities, it can still be managed better through some kind of framework or formal collaboration.
Thank you. Mark, we're going to come to you for some questions now, if that's all right.
Thanks, Convener. One thing I was quite struck by reading your submissions is just the lack of consistency across councils in terms of setting targets, in terms of the scope of those targets, in terms of the kind of plans that are being developed to meet those targets. Why is that, and is that a problem? Can we start with... can we go back to yourself, Louise, please?
Yeah, that's something that really jumped out in our climate conversation visits as well, actually, recently, working with people who work at a very much a national level. Local authorities really went for it with their climate declarations, I think, and found different ways of working out what they felt their contribution to the Paris-aligned targets, the Paris targets are. So some looked at remaining carbon budgets and others went for a figure earlier than the national figure. And they also scoop up different emissions baskets. So some are just looking at their own estate and what they think they can do. And others are looking at the wider area. And I think that the Audit Scotland, is that what you're called, Audit Scotland? That report that's just come out, that has a nice diagram showing this kind of wide disparity between local authorities. I think it was some of it was politics and some of it was looking at science. Why is it? I think it's because of local democracy and local areas are in control of that themselves, so they can set their own targets. We have the same thing in England. And to be honest, I don't think it really matters, because what it signals is there's a big ambition, there's a strong political commitment. Local people largely wanted this and campaigned for it, which is why we got some quite knee-jerk targets in there. And I think some authorities really see it as an opportunity to have a green recovery, grab really good jobs, local jobs, deliver those COVID benefits of health, clean air, great housing. And if you look at, there is concern... Hang on, I can't see the pen from here. I'll just quickly say this. If you look at the sort of speed by which we have to bring emissions down globally, doing it as fast as we can between now and the sort of 2030s, especially in line with the Scottish net zero target of 2045, it's okay to go that fast.
Okay.
So I don't think we should dwell too hard on it, really.
Okay, thanks, Andrew.
I mean, I think very much, Mark, the point you've raised speaks to what I was saying right at the outset, and I was pleased to hear Louise echo the words collaboration as well, and Stephen mentioned it as well. And I don't disagree with the point about funding, I think it's important to say. But in terms of why is it happening, I mean, the councils, all 32 authorities are working in this area, they are often working alone, absolutely individually, and not working across the boundaries of local authority areas. I don't need to tell anybody in this room or anybody outside this room that climate emissions do not respect council boundaries, never mind national boundaries. And we all know, sitting in this room, that we've got a 75% reduction by 2030, which is perilously close now. We're weeks away from 2023. And net zero, I think, as Louise just said as well, by 2045 at a Scotland-wide level. And I'm pleased to say, you know, that those individual councils that are working well are working really well in Scotland. There's a UK-wide organisation, I think it's called Climate Emergency UK, which has done a piece of assessment of the vast majority of all local authorities across the whole of the United Kingdom. And the two biggest cities in Scotland, Edinburgh and Glasgow, come out really, really well in terms of their plans for tackling this. But some of the other local authorities do not come out well in comparison to not just counterparts in Scotland, but other counterparts in England. And there is a distinct lack of consistencies because councils are working in their own silos and not collaborating across the boundaries. I mean, it's important to say that 28 of the 32 have declared a climate emergency, which I presume everybody would welcome. Not welcome the fact that it's an emergency, but welcome the fact that they recognised it. So that over 80%. Many, all of those have set targets of different levels. And even within those differing levels of targets that individual councils have set, there's further confusion added by whether the target reductions for greenhouse gas emissions are for the local authority emissions or for the area-wide emissions. Only 17 of the 32 councils have actually set targets for area-wide emissions. And just that very fact alone just illustrates how there is confusion and a lack of cooperation and collaboration across the local authorities. Yeah. And I don't mean that in a negative sense. I think it just needs a bit more leadership and a bit more steer from the appropriate channels to make that happen. And it would make a significant difference because those who are doing less well could learn from those that have got best practice.
That bottom-up collaboration will help to build that consistency then, is your point?
I would make a strong argument from the work the Accounts Commission has done. When you look at how well, you know, comparatively, cities like Edinburgh and Glasgow are doing, that other local authorities could learn a lot from what's happening in the two big cities in Scotland. That's not to say that Edinburgh and Glasgow are perfect or not. I'm certainly not claiming that. But yes, I'm agreeing with the gist of what you're prompting me on, that if there was a bottom-up and also, you know, some more steer from Scottish Government level, I'm sure Stephen will come back here on the point about funding as well, but it, just a collaboration, as I said in the opening statement in response to the convener, across and within the levels of all government in Scotland and the UK would really help.
Thanks. Stephen, you got any points to add to that?
Yeah, I would, and as Andrew predicted, one of them was about finance. Within Unison, we have in our membership many of the carbon managers, the property managers, and all the rest, who are actually doing the work on the ground and trying to implement plans within the councils. And there is a fair amount of degree of perhaps not collaboration, but exchange of information. They talk to each other. They have their own networks. Within Unison, we have a green network, and many of them come to that and talk. So they're aware of what's going on elsewhere. And if you actually picked up all the good ideas from the 32 local authorities and were able to replicate them in everything, and all the 32 local authorities would be steaming ahead. But the problem is, we don't have the capacity to do all the good things. So councils, largely to do with finance, so I'll get that one over just now, we'll say, well, we can't do everything, therefore we'll focus on what we think is the most appropriate for us in our local area. We'd like to do what they're doing elsewhere, so on and so forth, but we don't have enough money. So that is a fundamental problem. Some of the funding streams that they have to give grants, for example, are, you know, in the scheme of things, you know, good, and some really good projects, but they're all very bitty. They're all very localised, and that's not a criticism, it's just that's the funding stream. But the other part of that, which prevents a greater consistency, is skills. We have a skills shortage in a whole number of areas within local government. Whether that be our planners, for example, in terms of the requirements to be able to plan there, we do require greater training, carbon literacy, or whatever you would call it specifically, is how do you plan for this kind of net zero future? We have, you know, similar skills gaps, training gaps in other parts of it, so that a number of councils have to bring in outside consultants at considerable expense to try and, you know, figure out how do we take these steps forward. And one of the collaborations, it seems to me, that we would certainly argue for is developing that kind of a public sector excellence that can actually draw on the expertise which is being developed in different areas, but draw it so it's not just kept within that local area. So within, you know, the lack of capacity, the skills and the finance, I think is part of the reason why you look at a picture and it looks inconsistent across the board. That's because I think people are doing what they can at a local level.
Okay, thank you.
Do you have any further questions on? Oh, okay, perfect, thank you. So I think we'll come to Jackie next. Jackie, you've got some questions, I believe.
Yeah, thank you and welcome, panel. It was really in regards to how the councils have responded to the climate change transparency and reporting part of this. Do you think that the councils have been adequately assessing and mitigating reporting the risks to the climate change in their area? If I can go to Andrew first, please.
Yeah. Thanks very much for the question, Jackie. I mean, I think on balance, from the evidence that we've got, my sort of simplistic answer to that would be yes, they are doing their best with the resources they've got available to report on the emissions and the emission reductions that are happening across the local areas. but without wishing to sort of repeat myself, as I said to Mark, I mean, there's a lot of inconsistency across what they are reporting in terms of whether it's area-wide or just council emissions in as regards the targets they've set. And I mean, it's not quite 50-50, but it's about 50-50, or 17-15 have got a different approach to the targets they've set. But the actual reporting is happening, but it is constrained by resources. And I do agree with Stephen's latter point. It's not just about finance, it's about skills and human resources as well. It's worth saying, I think I'm correct in saying that just in a few months, in November, all public bodies are going to have a statutory and climate change report that they'll have to submit. And that could well be a mechanism for helping to improve the consistency across all 32 authorities in Scotland. I'm not familiar with all the details of how that annual report structure is going to be put together, but I suspect it might be something the committee could take an interest in terms of potentially using that as a tool to help improve consistency, which I think is really the point behind your question. I hope that helps.
If you ruled the world sort of thing, have you got an idea of how to improve that consistency? What would you say to the local authorities that they need to be doing to ensure that everyone is reporting the same?
Well, I think the one big change that could be made is that the net zero targets, whenever those targets are, that all 32 authorities, they either all report for their own emissions or they all report for area-wide emissions. At the minute, as I've said, it's 17-15. It's split almost right down the middle. And I think Louise mentioned the figures. You know, council emissions are actually relatively small in the global scheme of things, but area-wide emissions are really, really significant to Scotland achieving 75% reduction by 2030 and net zero by 2045. So if it was me and I could insist on something, like you're hinting at, then I think it would be that there's a consistency in terms of which one of those is it that councils are setting the target for. Is it overall emissions for the whole area, or is it reduction in emissions, or is it just reduction in emissions for the local authority? And they're clearly, given what I've just said, the more important one to focus on, given the scale of what I've just mentioned, and I think Louise hinted at, it's the area-wide emissions that really need to be looked at, because they form a significant part of the overall emissions for Scotland.
Okay. Stephen, could I ask if you would agree with that way forward, especially as you were speaking about earlier about the housing aspect of things, so that's going to be huge moving forward.
Yeah, I would agree with what Andrew's saying. I think my previous point about lack of skills and knowledge, I think, is what's one of the points. I mean, local authorities have been stripped of capacity over many, many years. And therefore, when they're asked to do things such as the area-wide corporate emissions, it's quite difficult. And that's a skill gap that which you don't have. Another area is procurement, for example. Councils are huge procurers of all sorts of things, food and all the rest of it. But they're tied into procurement processes which don't actually make it easy to assess what the climate impact is. So I would think the scope to improve upon that and improve that skills base. And I think that's probably best on a collaborative basis, to echo what Andrew's been saying, because unless we have that, we won't be able to be. They can be as transparent as one, but they'll be vague.
Thank you. And if I can just finish off by asking Louise, you were saying in your submission, Louise, that the finance directors need to understand what is actually needed before we can progress further in regards to that. Can you maybe just elaborate a bit more about what you were meaning when you were saying that?
Yeah, I'll just picking up on the data point as well. Local authority, so at least in Scotland, they do report, which is more than we have to do in England, interestingly. We can have an issue where you might have we've reported lack of data on housing, but then you can or transport data for a particular city or area might be extrapolated from national data, so it's not actually that helpful always. So we can get buried in the need for more and more and more data without thinking what data is useful here that will help us deliver the things we know we have to deliver by way of housing energy efficiency or modal shift for transport. So we can, if we pin everything on data, we can waste a lot of resources on it. Whereas good enough is sometimes got to be good enough to get going fast enough. On the piece about finance directors' understanding is they're the ones who they, and it links back to the point Stephen just made about procurement as well, is there are ways local authorities can really unlock transformational change. And it needs more than just the sort of climate person or the housing person to understand how to do that. So there are often finance solutions which, once your finance director or treasurer has gone through carbon literacy training, for example, the penny drops and they think, why are we investing in gas boilers in these schools when we've just dug up a playground and could have put in an a ground source heat pump? That'll be cheaper to run in the long term. So they getting everyone across the leadership team trained up and getting hold of those models of what's working in certain other councils, of how did other ones do this, to fill in those gaps is really important. So a sort of base level of skill and awareness, and then a way to go and get hold of expertise through exchanges like Sustainable Scotland Network or UK 100, which some of your local councils are members or your, I think you've got an Energy Managers Association. So as long as they understand the principles, then they can go and get the answers or the sort of business models or borrow the Excel spreadsheets of someone else. I think then they can be very solutions focused. And I think that's really important. And I think you've got speakers in the next session from those kinds of organisations who can help really share that and make that happen on a practical level.
Can I just ask a question, Stephen? You and other panel members have made the point that some of the people lacking the skills in the areas that are required. Took me 4 years to get trained in planning law and planning. How are we going to train these people up in the time? And are we have we changed our training at the moment to make sure that their new people coming in are properly trained?
I'd have to say I can't comment specifically on the current level of training for planners, convener. That's not an area of expertise. I think what the point I was making is that the current staff, the current planners, the current property managers and so on and so forth, who are professional and trained to that degree, many of them trained at a time when these issues weren't really pertinent, or what should have been, but weren't. It's about training. So the carbon literacy training that Louise just mentioned, for example, I know a number of councils have rolled that out across a number of staff. And I also agree with Louise's point, it's not just about training the planner or the carbon manager, it's about training the finance director and the chief executive and all this. So I think that's the critical issue. You need to speak to the universities, I think, and the professional organisations specifically about the training of the new professionals. But I think we need to find ways to bring up to speed and enhance the existing skills of the existing staff and the existing local government leaders.
Thank you. I'm a little bit concerned that we're not running as fast with that as perhaps we should be. The next questions come from Liam Kerr. Liam.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. I'll direct my first question to Louise first, and then I'll come to you, Andrew. Louise, it's very clear from your submission and from what we've heard from the panel this morning that local authorities are working in a very difficult financial environment due to what you in your submission call things like short-term funding settlements, which you suggest leads to financial teams not being focused on the whole life costs of a project. So the question I have for you, Louise, in the first instance, is how well do you think local authorities are linking their strategic carbon reduction plans and delivery route maps to their actual budget setting? And what more could they be doing to align projects and investments to their net zero ambitions?
I don't know how well all of them are linking that together, because I've sort of not done an audit of Scottish authorities. But I'd say, based on the authorities which I know quite well, which does include some of the Scottish ones, I'm not aware of local authorities linking their budget setting very strongly to that. I think there's probably a few leading ones, so I'd move that maybe Bristol and Manchester and Glasgow might be starting to, but I'd have to go away. I can go away, yeah. I will go away and find out, because I can't tell you who is and who is.
I'd be very grateful.
I don't want to misrepresent someone, because somebody might be. But what I will say quickly is someone like Glasgow City Region Council are aligning economic development plans to net zero. And that should filter down, because if they've got an overall place strategy that really picks up on net zero, as well as adaptation and inclusive growth, then that will cascade down through other strategies or action plans across directorates, and then we'll start to see it get a grip on it. And we're seeing that in Glasgow and some other members of the Inclusive Growth Network, and I think there's a link to that report I've done on there in my submission. So we're beginning to see it get embedded. Some of them are using things like the donut economics model, but I'm not aware of any Scottish authorities doing that. And again, I could be wrong. So I'll go away and do some homework and come back to you.
I'm very grateful. Andrew Burns, your thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, I think from the work that the Counts Commission has done, I referenced how well comparatively Glasgow and Edinburgh are doing compared to the other, not just 30 authorities in Scotland, but sister organisations and councils down south as well. They are linking decisions around budget to climate reduction targets, but it's not consistent across many other local authorities. And I was pleased to hear Louise mention the Glasgow City Region area, because I think that's referenced as one of the case studies in the piece of work that the Council Commission has done as a good example of how economic decision making can and should be linked to climate greenhouse gas emission reduction targets. And Edinburgh and a few other local authorities in Scotland are also doing likewise, but it's very, very few. It's not consistent and it's not very prevalent in Scotland at all. I couldn't speak to the wider picture in the rest of the UK, I'm afraid.
Thank you very much. My second question, and Stephen, I'll bring you in a second, and you might want to address that first question then, but stick with you, Andrew Burns. Given the financial situation that we've heard so much about, what impact do you foresee the pay increases, the Scottish Government spending cuts, and the current inflationary pressures having on local authorities' ability to deliver on their net zero ambitions? And given how councils are funded, what can they do about it?
Well, I mean, frankly, it doesn't take a mathematician to realise that it makes it harder. You know, there's huge pressures on local authorities. You know, surely we can be apolitical about this as well. You know, no matter where you're coming from, it must be obvious to anybody, all of us are users of local council services, that the pressure on delivery of those services is enormous at the moment. And, you know, whether it's pay settlements or establishment of new national care service, or, you know, we could go through a whole host of things, you know, which really aren't necessarily the remit of this committee, but they do cause pressure to then be forced onto the resources that are available to achieve greenhouse gas emissions and net zero targets. So they do all have a cumulative impact, and that cumulative impact is negative.
Mm-hmm. And anything you think that they can do about it, given the constraints of what's the funding?
I mean, I wish I could sit here and give you, you know, a one-word, you know, golden sort of rule answer, but I don't have that. But again, in danger of slight repetition, but what would help, it wouldn't solve everything, but what would help is that improved collaboration across local authorities and between the different levels of government in Scotland. Now, my statement of the obvious, you know, if more funding was available, that would of course also help, but if we put that to the side for the moment and potentially assume that there's no additional funding, then, you know, that more effective collaboration would assist. It's not going to solve all of these challenges, and maybe not in response to yourself, Liam, but it might lead us on to a bit of a discussion about adaptation in a minute, because, you know, that's one area where I think there's potential for improvements around all of the local authorities' plans as they stand at the moment.
Very grateful. Stephen Smellie, your thoughts?
Yeah, I think it's very difficult. The last time I was in a meeting with government ministers, with Deputy First Minister and the First Minister about the pay settlement, and that was spelled out very clearly to us that if we were getting extra money on the pay, which we did, which we're obviously very grateful about, there was consequences for that, and that's the reality of both Scottish Government and local authority spending. I think there are clearly things which could be done in terms of increasing revenue-raising powers for local government, which Unison is very supportive of and has done over a number of years. There's other things the Scottish Government could do in terms of raising additional funds locally. Before we get into a discussion about what Westminster should be doing, and additional borrowing powers and so on and so forth. So there are things that could be done. None of them are short-term fixes, it has to be said, but they need to be looked at. The other thing is priorities. I mean, local government and all governments will have to make decisions over the next period of time. And going back to your first question, if they don't link them to the net zero objectives, then we will end up going backwards, not forwards, because they'll be making short-term decisions on basically a financial. So the new swimming pool that might be going to get built will be the cheapest available swimming pool, or will we build a swimming pool that will meet our net zero targets for the future. And that, for a finance director, that's a very difficult choice to make. And for any councillor elected on a four-year, five-year term, again, these are difficult choices. So we could start making priorities. For example, I talked about skill shortage. I mean, we could actually move people away from improving roads, for example, or creating new junctions, to actually move those kind of engineers into doing more work on safer travel and more active travel pursuits. So there are things like that could be done within current arrangements, simply to say, well, we won't build more roads, we'll instead devote that money to retrofitting our buildings to make them more energy efficient and so on and so forth. So there's things like that could be done.
I understand. Very grateful. Unless Louise Marix-Evans has anything to add, I'll hand back to the convener. Thank you.
Louise was too slow in looking up if she did, but maybe Monica, I think, has got some questions on this, so she might be able to come in on that.
Thank you, convener, and thank you to our panel. I have a question on procurement, which has been mentioned already, but I'll just come back to this issue of capacity, which we hear about often in very sort of broad terms. But I think what Stephen's described as, very sort of lean model of local government, where we have shed a lot of staff over the years. I just wonder briefly if each of our witnesses could maybe let us know if we're doing workforce plans across local government. Do we know exactly, in an ideal world, how many staff we need in certain roles? We talk a lot about workforce planning for the NHS, for example, but not always in a great detail in terms of what local government actually needs. So I'll become to Louise first and then round the table to find out if that work, even if it's happening perhaps in England, Louise, and if you've got any good examples of that. But just a sense of what do we actually need, and what kind of jobs should we be training people for, and thinking maybe, Stephen, in terms of just transition, how those agendas link. So I'll come to Louise first.
I think I'd say that rather than saying you need this many climate change officers per council or per head of population, I think it would go back to having everyone trained so that everyone knows what their role does towards net zero and understands what the co-benefits of that is, so that if they look through a net zero lens at the work they're doing, then they're contributing towards that. So that's the first thing I'd say, rather than siloing it off into a climate change department. So you've got your highways people, your economic development people doing things that run against net zero, whilst you've got a little climate change team trying to pull the other way. And we do see that in councils. I would really invest in my housing team, and I'd invest in people who begin to understand how to develop business models towards, I think, nailing the owner-occupier retrofit challenge, building up business models for and skills bases for people delivering retrofit. And I think you've started on that journey with your home energy efficiency programmes in Scotland. So I'd say those are really important. And I think the other one is about getting, for the modal shift piece, getting people in who really understand about active travel and I think a bit of a mindset change from your traditional highways engineer, so that we have proper engagement and really good design of very high quality ways of travelling actively or moving ourselves differently. And so that's completely different to the kind of people who want to just stack cars in the car parks or keep traffic flowing. And those are the kind of people I end up sort of tearing my hair out over. So, yeah, I think those are two important ones. And the last one I'd say is people who are really good at engaging with local communities and working and building other partnerships, because it's not all on local authorities to deliver. It has to be done with partners at a much more micro level, community level. And that takes resources and is totally worth developing. And we saw that in Dundee, and we see that in Glasgow as well. Putting resources into people who can do the practical stuff on the ground and build partnerships so other people can deliver. So, yeah.
Thank you, Louise. I suppose when I asked the question, I was making an assumption that everyone working in local government is part of the mission in terms of net zero goals, and that we are trying to mainstream this. So it's not just about somebody who's got green or climate in their job title. It's trying to embed that. So thank you for that. I'll come to you, Stephen.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a critical point. I mean, although it has to be said that local authorities, with the funding streams they've had recently, where they've been trying to recruit specific people to take forward some of these programmes, are competing against each other and struggling to recruit people with green in their title or that kind of specialist knowledge. That is a difficulty that is out there and can't be ignored. But I do agree that it's about training up the people we've got who could do the job better or greener, more greener in that. Local government doesn't have a workforce planning mission, if you like. It's not something that's 32 local authorities who are effectively compete with each other. And indeed, in some of the areas that we're talking about here, are competing with the private sector to recruit that kind of talent. And that's one of the things which is getting clear, that within that kind of professional level, it's difficult to recruit and difficult to retain some people because the pay has been suppressed for a number years. We're not open up with that particular line, but it's just a fact that there are difficulties in retaining staff within those areas because there are better paid jobs elsewhere. So there is a need for us to look at that. I come back to the point about training existing staff, and as Louise has made the point about training the whole team, and you've made the point yourself, Monica, but everybody in local government should really have this as part of their job, and they should have an understanding. One of the things that I'm keen on promoting is engagement, greater engagement with the workforce, and how they can transform the way in which they deliver services. And we've various examples across the country of where that's been tried, where people, you know, for a very simple, in the past, starting to, a number of years ago, we talked about, you know, moving to paperless, what does that mean? And yet, you know, when staff start to get into it, then they start coming up with their own ideas. And the home working that we all were forced to do over COVID has opened up people's ideas. Well, maybe we don't need to travel to all these different meetings. So there's a whole lot. If you engage with the workforce, they can come up with ideas without necessarily having green in their job description. And you mentioned Just Transition. One of the things which we are very pleased to see in the latest Just Transition Commission report is when they talked about the need to invest in the social infrastructure of the country. By that, I mean health and social care and things like that. And of course, local government has a critical role in investing that and training up social care workers and others to create the kinds of jobs that we need to create in the future, which are green jobs. We don't tend to think of them as green jobs, but they are. They don't cause climate greenhouse gas emissions, as long as they've got an electric car to be able to go and visit their service users, I suppose. So there is a role for local government in developing that kind of transition into that kind of economy that we need in the future. So that, the local government also has that. And that, again, as you say, that should be part of the workforce planning and also the financial planning of all local government.
That's really helpful. Thank you, Stephen. Andrew, your thoughts and reflections?
Thanks, Mark. I mean, I wonder if I could try and link your question about workforce plans to adaptation, which I mentioned earlier on, because I really think there's an important point to try and get across on that from the work that the Accounts Commission has done. So I think, yes, individual local authorities, as Stephen and Louise have already indicated, do have workforce plans. I mean, the Accounts Commission knows this from the best value work that we do for all 32 individual local authorities. But they're individual workforce plans within each local authority. But the something that came out really, really powerfully in the work that we did was that there is a big focus on greenhouse gas emissions without hardly any sort of serious focus on adaptation. And I think this is a point that doesn't often get discussed enough, but I think I am right in saying, I'm sure, that we are never going to get to net zero. Never. There's always going to be residual emissions, greenhouse gas emissions. And if we don't have adaptation and some forms of sequestration, then we're never going to be able to remove those residual emissions. And that, linking that to your point about workforce plans and the need for training of the workforce, from the evidence that we've got before us from the survey we did of all 32 authorities, that is something that is not being given the level of attention. And it's not just councils in the public sector, it potentially is private sector as well. But if I was to ask everybody in this room to put their hands up if they had a gas boiler, I'll bet you that to heat their house, I'll bet you more than half of us would have to put our hands up. And we're nowhere near ready from the evidence that we've got in tackling that problem going forward. And I think, therefore, there is an issue around appropriate workforce planning for dealing with residual emissions, because we are going to have residual emissions. Greenhouse gas will never be zero. Net zero doesn't mean that. And we're going to have adaptation. And adaptation, I don't think, has been proper, from the evidence we've got, isn't being properly assessed and looked to in the workforce planning of individual authorities. Hope that makes sense.
Monica, do you want to come back in very briefly? I'm glad we didn't have a vote on gas boilers, because it's not something in the Highland we see much of. But Monica,
I'll move on to procurement, but just keen to ask Andrew, well, why, adaptation is not given that priority? Why is that? Can you put your finger on it or your pen on it?
Yeah, I mean, regrettably, I'm not sure I can. You know, it's just a statement of what we found from the piece of work that we've done. I mean, I don't doubt it's linked to the pressures that are on local authorities. You know, they've got greenhouse gas emission targets and net zero targets that they're working towards, and they've identified those. But I don't think there's enough focus on just dealing with what's going to be a small element of residual emissions, because they're not going to go away.
Stephen?
Just on the adaptation, two things. I'll be brief. Councils manage lots of land, and they have responsibilities for doing that. And many have projects to plant more trees, engage children, for example, in schools and tree planting and stuff like that. That's small parts of it, but that's the kind of work that needs to be greater investment in. The other thing on adaptation is adaptation in the sense of adapting to the current climate change. Low authorities have to plan for the extreme weather conditions that we see more frequently, the flooding that takes place, the water shortages that we get. Local authorities are having to plan for all that in terms of their own infrastructure, fixing the roads and rebuilding the bridges and all that kind of stuff, adapting their buildings. We, along with SDUC and Adaptation Scotland, developed some training material for workplaces about how you audit workplaces for adaptation. How is climate change impacting on us now, everything from temperature to ventilation and outdoor working and all the rest of it. So Andrew's right, there's not enough done in that, but there has been work done by the trade unions along with Adaptation Scotland to start getting that understood in workplaces. And I think that's, if we had sufficient time, and we don't, but if we had sufficient time, then we could see progress by engaging in the workforce. And one of the things, just very quickly, one of the things which I think local government could take a lead on is identifying within the workforce, the green reps, in the same way as under legislation for health and safety reps who get facility time to inspect and all the rest of it, we could actually start developing, training up people to be either green reps, environment reps, whatever we would call them, to carry out those kind of audits within workplaces, working with management, but represent the workforce and how we should do that. And that would be a key step forward in trying to get this message into every workplace, initially in local government, but there's no reason why that wouldn't then be examples that could go elsewhere.
Thank you, Stephen. I'm going to come to Natalie now, who's got some questions. Natalie, the microphone is yours, as it were.
Thank you very much, Convener. I'm going to come to Louise first with this question, and I'm interested around the role of communities and whether you feel that there's a mismatch between the scale at which local government and local community groups operate in relation to delivering net zero, and if so, how you feel that this should be addressed. So evidence gathered today in the inquiry suggests that partnerships between councils and community groups is variable dependent on the area. So how should local authorities change culture to ensure that communities become key partners in the delivery of net zero?
I think it's really important, and I think when you're looking at the scale of what's got to be delivered and you're looking at, you know, numbers of houses that need to be tackled by retrofit, and then you're looking at a little nice little community partnership for, you know, bicycle, you know, refurbishment and getting people on bikes, it feels like a tiny crumb compared to this vast sort of cake we've got to tackle. But I think it's absolutely critical for people to be empowered, and it goes back to Monica's point about the just transition, is we can't really accept this transition being done to us, particularly when we get into the areas that are going to change the way we move, the way we live, the kind of jobs we have, what we buy and eat. So you can change the electricity system without us particularly noticing that the cost might be an issue. But I think a partnership or a way that local communities can feed in and really engage and co-create ideas and solutions with local authorities or with government as well is really important, so that we can help shape what is going to happen, what this better future should look like for us, that we can see what the benefits are, the opportunities. And again, we think of communities maybe as people in houses, but communities are also made up of businesses, small businesses, enterprises. And then they might see opportunities to develop new services, create new enterprises. So where local authorities go into partnerships with quite an open mind, rather than saying, we are engaging with you so that you agree with our plan, or we are engaging with you so that you consent to what we're going to do in your town or local area, that's no good. But where they come in and say, look, this is a problem, we've got to change the way we're moving around here in this bit of Dundee or wherever, how are we going to do it? They can come up with solutions, and that gives support to the elected members to go, well, they want it, let's do it. It means more people have a voice, so it's not just the noisy campaigners who can sort of say, I don't want this. And I think it's empowering, and the people we've met who've been part of community climate plans or engaged in different ways, maybe through arts, as we see with Creative Dundee, that it's, well, I mean, it makes you feel like you have agency. And I'm not being very articulate, sorry, but I do think it's really important. And I think for big, high-level policymakers, it can seem like it's not a big, nice infrastructure thing or a big chunk of money that you can spend and deliver emissions like that, but it is absolutely critical. And I think we're seeing more deliberative democracy coming through by way of climate juries and things like that. And the CCC, the Climate Change Committee, have really started looking at this in earnest now, which I think is great. So it's very important.
Thank you. So as well as knowing the area best, you feel that cooperation between local authorities and communities is going to be key to ensuring that sort of buy-in from local people and citizens. And actually, you touched on my next point, which I was going to ask, what other forms of democracy might help to ensure community involvement, and how should these be initiated and supported? But you have touched on that, so I'll maybe turn over to Andrew for your thoughts on that, please.
Yeah, no, thanks, Natalie. I mean, I would say from the evidence that we've got before us in terms of the Accounts Commission survey of local authorities across Scotland, this is an area of the partnership working between local authorities and communities that is actually a strength in Scotland. I'm not wanting to claim for one second that it's perfect across the whole of Scotland, but it is a strength. There's various case studies in the submission, the report that we just put out a couple of weeks ago that was submitted to the committee that show this. You know, Dumfries and Galloway, Aberdeenshire, Glasgow City Region, we've already mentioned, where there's lots of really good work and good partnership going on with local communities. And in many ways, it's all about empowering below are not equivalent to the tier that you represent. And you know, we've been making that discussion and having that debate in some ways about Scottish Government, local government level. We've got to make the same arguments and have the same discussion about local government and community level. And I think it is a strength in Scotland, but it's not perfect. I wouldn't like to sit here and claim it's perfect. It could be improved, but there's lots of good practice. And I do agree with the latter point Louise made. There's things like deliberative juries and so on that could deliberative decision making that could all help. And many neighbourhood partnerships inside the 32 authorities are working well on that with partner bodies like police boards, fire boards, and so on. And it's not something we drilled down to in detail, but I'm sure the committee could establish fairly easily some further examples of what works well at a neighbourhood partnership level, as well as the work that we've done at the Accounts Commission.
Thanks very much, Andrew. I'm not sure if Stephen, if you have anything to add, but otherwise I'm happy to pass back to the convener on this one.
I think Stephen does have something to add. Yeah. Briefly,
oh,
Stephen.
Brilliant. I wasn't sure. I couldn't see you there. Sorry.
Yeah, I'd have to declare an interest. My background is in community development work, so I do have lots of ideas about communities and what we should do. In my view, every community should have its own net zero plan, or should be working to. How does our community, our village, our scheme, whatever, how do we address these issues ourselves, and what does it mean for us? And one of the things which, I mean, there's lots of good examples, but on a relatively small scale, because the community, let's be honest with it, don't actually get involved. They either don't feel empowered to get involved, or they don't have the confidence involved, or they don't have the resources. And one of the things which local authorities can be good at, and it's very patchy. Community development workers is one of the areas which has been stripped out of local government over many years, speaking personally. But where it works is when you actually are able to engage with local communities and think and get people starting to think about what's of concern to them and how does that then fit into a wider agenda. So at the moment, lots of people will be talking about energy and the costs. Now, there's ways in which local government could be engaging with communities on, as they have done in various parts of the country, in terms of community energy schemes. Now, that could be magnified in great ways. Much of the local authority land, for example, could be worked with local communities to see, well, whether local district heating schemes and local energy production could be there. The roofs of everybody's house could be solarised and so on and so forth. And what stops people doing that themselves individually is the cost of it. But if you were actually giving support to community organisations, street by street by street, village by village, they could collectively come together with some support and they could start making real progress in that, and people would feel that there's a gain for them in a relatively short period of time, and that would lead on to a greater development. So that kind of notion of, I mean, Unison's in favour of public energy, but that's a different committee, no doubt. But community energy would be part of that mix of public energy, rather than big companies being the ones who always get the benefits from these things, of big landowners who, you know, are able to provide the land. There's no reason why communities couldn't do that as well. And similarly with transport networks, one of the real concerns at the moment for lots of people, despite, you know, people of my age get free buses and all the rest of it, which we're very grateful, lots of people, and particularly in rural areas, and I come from South Lanarkshire, where there's large rural areas where there isn't a decent bus service. Transport services are something which a local community should be part of the design, and local authorities should be able to work alongside communities to develop those services.
Thank you, Stephen.
Thanks very much.
Is that you finished, Natalie?
Could you just have one follow-up on that, if that's all right?
Well, I'm nervous because the deputy convener hasn't had her questions yet, and there's nothing upsetting the deputy convener at your first meeting. So, Natalie, if you perhaps allow me to go to the deputy convener, and I may come back to you at the end.
Thank you.
Thank you, convener. Thank you, Natalie. I'd like to talk about the barriers and opportunities for councils in leveraging private finance. We've heard from councils that, yes, there are public pressures, we understand that, but the scale of this means that they don't expect the Scottish Government to provide all the funding, so therefore, how do we use private and green finance? So I'd like to come to yourself, Louise, first on that, and whether, in terms of skills and abilities and that framework of collaboration, is there something that more can be done in this? Have you got any recommendations for us?
Oh, Oh, yeah, I'm unmuted. Yeah, I mean, we know that the transition is not going to be funded by the public sector. It's going to come from largely from the private sector. I think we can look at local authorities already obviously work with the private sector, and they might have deals. We see Bristol City Leap, for example, non-Scottish example, setting up a joint venture to deliver a big heat network, as well as deep retrofit in buildings. And I think there are joint ventures for heat networks that you've got in Scotland, I believe. Glasgow's been working with the Climate Cities Investment Commission, which has modelled, how much it's going to cost. And you think, yeah, fine, I could have told you that actually before you did the research. But the next stage of it now is exciting. And I think there's a conference that was due but was probably cancelled last week to actually bring together investors with the city to say, what are the opportunities? But I think this is maybe where it gets really hard for local authorities, because you have some people who understand all these finance models and joint ventures and special purpose vehicles and so on. And then you have ordinary people like me who think, well, who's benefiting? Are we just paying more, like with private finance initiative? Are we paying more over longer and somebody else owns it? If they go bust, we carry the risk. So there's a lot of thinking about aggregating mixed risk bags of investment that we then bring investment in from the private sector to deliver this long-term infrastructure challenge. But the problem is so much of it isn't rapidly investable. So energy is, that's fine. But things like the sort of long-term impacts of housing retrofit takes a long time to get that payback and to get that revenue stream back to service the debt. So I still think it's underdeveloped. We get little things we see, like green bonds. Maybe they raise £1 million through community bonds. We've seen that in Berkshire and Warrington. I don't know if there's a Scottish example, but that's only £1 million, and it's often for just a solar farm or something. It's not for the really difficult stuff to make payback, and we're not yet able to sell the sort of carbon emissions or the health benefits through social bonds. So there's a lot of talk about it, and there's lots of really clever people in smart suits who talk about it, but I still don't see it kind of being a true example that I can get my head around yet. So it's sort of, to me, it seems a bit smoke and mirrors, and I think it's certainly a skill that might exist in authorities, and I'm sure Kit England in Glasgow is busy recruiting somebody to do this kind of stuff, and he understands it. But until elected members and ordinary members of the public can get their heads around it, I think it's going to be difficult. I think it's coming, and it's there in some places, but it's not, is by no means everywhere, and it's a big gap. And I think it's a gap the government might be able to help, but I think the finance industry really needs to help us.
And is that something that you see a framework, you know, between national and local government and regional government addressing?
I think it could, but I think a lot of the time private investors say you have to de-risk it and then we'll invest.
Yeah.
And that's fine. But where the risk lies, I suppose that's not for me. I'm not an elected member. But I think there is a pipeline that needs developing, and it has to be a very wide pipeline, because getting the projects away is a narrow funnel. So we lose a lot of projects in the process. I'm a bit out of my comfort zone on this, but it's something that really exercises me, because I don't see enough happening, and I hear a lot of talk about it, but it doesn't strike me as transparent or practical enough. There's a lot of theory, and I'd like to see more real projects coming through.
So I'm going to turn to Andrew Burns now. What is your view on this leverage of private finance, and is there a conflict between councils being responsible for their own estate, but at the same time we're saying we either need community and or place-based investments, in which case the council should also be leveraging private finance for things that are actually income generating, or there's an income source that might not be generated, obviously, from their own stock.
Yeah. I think it's a really important point, and I think given everything we've just been discussing around the fiscal pressures that are on local authorities and the slim chance of that magically going to become, you know, markedly better in the short term, then leveraging in and accessing private finance is absolutely essential. And I know it's been referenced a couple of times by various members who have been given evidence this afternoon, but I would just reference the Climate Ready Clyde example that's in our submission, the piece of work that the Accounts Commission did, because it does involve the whole of the 8 local authorities across the Glasgow City region, plus I believe 6 or 7 other organisations, some from the private sector. It has had Scottish Government support and funding. It could be something that could be rolled out across the other, because I think I'm right in saying it's the only specific example where there's been that cross-authority and inter-private public sector collaboration in Scotland with government support. And it's not necessarily a magic bullet, but I would encourage colleagues to have a look at the case study for in this submission from the piece of work that we did just last, or we published just last week, because it does illustrate there's potential there to leverage in private sector finance. And City region deals, they're not everybody's favourite mechanism, but they have already illustrated in a different arena, I acknowledge, how private sector finance can be leveraged into local authority areas. And if Climate Ready Clyde can prove that can have an impact on climate greenhouse gas emissions and adaptation targets, then I think it would be well worth looking at that carefully in terms of potentially a model that could be rolled out across the other city region deal areas, because I think there's now one that covers every local authority area of Scotland.
And is that the way to make sure that the finance expertise can be shared? Because clearly smaller local authorities may not have that.
Yeah, I mean, I think in particular small local authorities, without wishing to sound, you know, urban central, you know, they do struggle because they do have a lack of capacity and a lack of access to those human resources. And so, yes, I think it could be a way of making sure that small local authorities have access. And some of the 8 local authorities inside the Clyde, Climate Ready Clyde City Region deal that I've just referenced will be relatively small in comparison to Glasgow, and they will be leveraging in expertise and private sector human resources as well as capital through this mechanism.
And Stephen, finally, if I can ask you about what your view on leveraging of private finance can be, bearing in mind you yourself identified it, you know, issues around community bonds, which is private finance but from communities. The committee was meant to, unfortunately, you know, we had to cancel a visit, which was to Linlithgow, which has already done that in a solar bond exercise. So what, you know, if the big ticket items are housing and transport, and you've talked about how you can mobilise the workforce and the expertise. What can we do in relation to private finance, and what are the barriers that you see? But also, what are the opportunities? Because we're the best will in the world, nobody's saying that public funding will be able to tackle net zero.
I think that it'll come as no great surprise I'm a bit of a sceptic when it comes to private finance. I don't think there's any record, any evidence of private finance going to be coming in to rescues in this situation. Our history of experience in using private financing for public infrastructure, PFI Louise mentioned in passing, was not successful. I don't think anybody would go back to those days when PFI was the only game in town, as we used to be told in local government, and we're still paying off years and years and years later. In fact, the government have had to extend the period of times when we can pay off that. So I don't think that there are, and in fact, the whole history of moving to renewables internationally is evidence that actually, unless the public purse actually funds it, subsidises it, or allows you to charge significantly more for the energy, the private sector don't come in, because the only thing the private sector are not interested in generating energy, or indeed in saving energy, they're interested in generating profits. And in a situation where public finances are tight, why would we commit to a strategy which essentially just means we're going to hawk for even more years? So I am a sceptic about that. I don't think there is much evidence that will come to a rescue, and therefore I do think we do need to start thinking about public sector responses to this. Community engagement is fine, and there is room for it at small levels, but it is small beer in terms of the bigger picture. I don't think there's any getting away from the fact that the public sector using borrowed money, and I appreciate the difficulties that they have. Local authorities can borrow money if they're allowed to in certain circumstances. We don't have that capacity at the government level in Scotland. We do need to start addressing those kind of issues, because I don't think, Unison does not think, that the private sector will deliver on these kind of issues and the scale that would be necessary. And I'm sorry to be so negative about that, but that's our assessment.
Can I just finally, just very briefly ask, does Unison agree that councils should be leaders in a place-based approach to tackle net zero, or should they only be interested in public services and public sector responsibilities?
I think Unison is very firmly of the view that local government has a very key role to play in, as you describe it, place-based solutions. Absolutely, engaging with local communities, engaging with businesses and integrating effort and all the rest of it. But that's not the same as saying that they are going to be able to bring in private finance. The private finance isn't there.
Okay, thank you.
Now, the two members who've asked to ask questions, so I'm going to let them both in. First of all, Monica, but I'm going to say to you both at the outset, a short question to one panel member to allow Natalie to come in after you, Monica.
Okay, I'm going to ask a question about the Scottish National Investment Bank. So I don't know maybe if Louise or Andrew can indicate if they're best placed to answer, but I think it would be good if Stephen Smiley could follow up maybe in writing to the committee, because Unison did publish a report last year on decarbonising public sector, and I'm certainly keen to hear what engagement there's been with COSLA, Accountants Commission and others about that report. But the role of the investment bank, we've not heard about that today. Do we have anyone who can maybe speak to that very, very briefly?
Andrew, looks like you're up, and if you're brief, Stephen might get in as well, so it depends if you're currying favour with him.
Thanks very much, Monica. I'm not sure, convener, I can be overly helpful on this. I mean, it's not something that was looked at in detail as part of the work that the Accounts Commission undertook. I think it's a good question, though, and one that the committee, I hope, will further pursue, because my understanding as an individual is that that was one of the aspirations behind the establishment of the National Investment Bank, was that it would be able to invest in assistance for climate greenhouse gas emissions and adaptation as well, which we've referenced a couple of times this afternoon. So it's not something we've looked at, I don't think, yet in detail, but I think it's a good point, and it is a body that could potentially assist.
Thank you.
I would refer to the STUC submission, which actually does address this issue of the role of the National Investment Bank. I wouldn't pretend to be an expert on it either. The other thing I would link into that, however, is we have in Scotland a source of funding in the local government pension schemes of billions of pounds, which currently invests in, you know, continue to invest in fossil fuels, which is, there's an issue there about divestment. The local authorities have a key role. They run the local government pension scheme, so there is an issue there as well about how that kind of money could be invested. It has to have a return, the same, because it's my pension that we're looking for after, not primarily about investment infrastructure, but there is a source of that. And one of the things which we're campaigning for is actually to review 11 funds with lots of duplication. There's about £100 million could be saved every year by merging those funds into one. So in terms of an immediate, well, it'll take a wee bit of time to put in place, as to be said, but over a period of a few years, we could actually be looking at significant savings in that, which would come directly to local government. That would be something worth exploring.
Okay, Natalie, do you want to come back with your question to one individual, please?
Thank you, convener. Yeah, it was just on the back of what you were saying, Stephen. So I apologise, I didn't realise your background. And it was just in relation to, so you said that one of the biggest challenges for communities is the finance side of it. So it's just, do you feel there are any other challenges for community-led emissions, and what can we do to help that, and what action can we as policymakers take to reduce these barriers?
Just very briefly, I mean, in your previous question, you asked about levels of democracy, and I agree that, you know, finding ways to engage people in their local community, and whatever community they identify in, because it's not all about, you know, the village they live in or whatever, sometimes communities of interest and so on and so forth, or workplace communities as well, but engaging people in that and partly educating, partly raising awareness, but also giving them opportunities to say, well, how their situation could be improved upon, would elicit all sorts of ideas, some of which would be daft, there's no doubt about it, some of which would be unrealistic because of the finances involved in it, but there's no doubt that people, given the opportunity and given a bit of funding, we're not necessarily talking about lots of funding in some of these aspects, but given a little bit of funding, they could come up with solutions to their own immediate problems. And local authorities, I think, are best placed to be able to harness that, coordinate with other communities, and get back to Andrew's point about collaboration, communities also collaborating to achieve their own improved energy sources or transport networks, which would help to address the net zero in the widest sense within the community. So I think there are real opportunities there, which if we're able to unlock them, would bring a lot more talent and a lot more ideas to the table.
Thank you. Thank you, Stephen. Thank you, Natalie, for that. And I haven't had to throw my pen at anyone, which is great news. I want to thank Louise, Stephen and Andrew for your contributions. And members, I'd like to briefly suspend the meeting to allow a changeover of witnesses. So I suspend the meeting. government inquiry. We need to hear, as we near the end of our evidence taking, we'd like to welcome COSLA and the Convention of Scottish Local Authorities, SOLAS, the Society of Local Authority Chief Executives and Senior Managers, and today to offer their perspective for local authority leaders. Now, we'd also like to welcome back a representative of the Sustainable Scotland Network. So I welcome our panellists today who are all joining us remotely. There's Councillor Gail McGregor of COSLA, spokesperson on the environment, economy and for Dumfries and Galloway Council. David Hammond, the representative of SOLAS and head of sustainability, corporate property and transport, North Ayrshire Council. Silke Eisbrand, the policy manager for the environment economy team at COSLA, and George Tarvitt, the director of SSN. Thank you for joining us today and taking time today as we had to rearrange the panel. Now, the problem is you're all remote, so I can't wave my pen at you because you won't be able to see me. So it just, if you get too verbose, I apologise now, I'll just have to cut you off. So if you could just bear that in mind, that would be brilliant. The first question then for local authorities is, and in this section from me, is what do you think the biggest challenges for reducing emissions in local authorities are? Now, just a very brief answer from each of you would be really helpful, because then I'm going to ask Mark Ruskell to delve into that. So, Gail McGregor, do you want to go with that to start with? What is the biggest challenge? What are the biggest challenges?
Thank you very much, Convener, and good afternoon, members, and congratulations on your recent appointment as Convener. I'm sure I'll see your pen wagging if required. This is a massive agenda. We've spoken at length about it in previous committees, but we're sort of really reaching a edge now. To contextualise it, we're less than 100 months away from 2030 targets, which I think is quite a focus for the mind and really contextualises the pressure that we're under. I think in reality, to enable us to reach our targets, and there are many, obviously resourcing is an issue, a skill set issue as well. I think in the previous session, Monica mentioned workforce and the pressures around that. So the two main issues at the moment would probably be resource and ensuring that local government has the resources to place where it is required, and when required, and then obviously having the skills within local government to deliver on that as well. A lot of ambitious projects that are going to take people that truly understand the delivery of them, and at the moment we're seeing, you know, across councils that there is definitely a shortage in skilled workforce, but probably, and I'm afraid it's always the case, resources and finance will be the most pivotal one. But I have to say that local government is completely signed up to this, but we need to do it very much in greater collaboration with Scottish Government as well, and obviously direction from Parliament.
Thanks, Gail. David, what are your views on that?
Thank you, Convener. Can I just check that everyone can hear me okay?
Perfectly.
Great. Thanks for your question, Convener. You'll not be surprised that my answer will be very much along the same lines as Councillor McGregor. And the SOLAS view is very much that local government are geared up for the net zero challenge. But the most complex part of it for us is that resourcing issue and the flexibility in that resourcing. So ultimately, the net zero challenge has a price tag, and it's about the ability of local government to play its role in meeting that. It's not something that we're funded for at the moment. I'm sure as we get into the detail, we'll talk about some of the options around that funding, including private sector leverage. I was tuning into the previous session there, so I'm sure we'll touch on some of that later. But to summarise, it would be very much resourcing and flexibility in that, in any resourcing that's available. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, David. Silke.
Yeah? Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you perfectly.
Yes. Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
And absolutely, just to underline what Councillor Gail McGregor and what David have just said there, we've very much looked at the whole sort of like funding issue, and especially the flexibility of the funding. I think you heard sort of like in the earlier sessions that were held in the spring very clearly, for example, from Glasgow, you know, we do understand this, you know, this is a funding issue. No one level of government has got all the funding, not local government, not Scottish government, not even the UK government. So it is very much about being able to bring another other funding sources, and in order to do that effectively, we need flexible funding. I think we've gone much, much deeper, and I'm aware you've got our submission, where we go into details round about capacity, national infrastructure, behaviour change, skills, public sector frameworks, data baselining, and a lot of these issues speak to your question here as well, without me at this point in time wanting to go into detail. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I'm going to bring George in very briefly, if I may, George.
Sure. I suppose to touch on one thing that came up in the previous session, which hasn't been mentioned by colleagues so far, and it is the assuring collaboration, but really deep collaboration. We've got good collaborative structures in Scotland. You know, we do actually collaborate quite extensively through SSN and across POSLA, SOLAS and the Improvement Service and the likes. But I think there's a real desire and a need to deepen that collaboration and really align the sort of strategies, plans, programmes that we see within local government and the wider public sector to deliver on net zero. So I think we've got a lot of the foundations in place. We just need to invest in some of those solutions more actively.
Okay, thank you very much. And I'm going to come straight to Mark for your questions now, Mark.
Yeah, thanks for that, convener. I think just picking up on that last point, I mean, we're aware, and we had some evidence in the last panel, that there's a lot of inconsistency between local authorities. You know, the majority of them don't have area-wide targets. You know, the majority of them do have targets for their own emissions. But can I ask you what your organisations are doing to try and, you know, develop that more coherent approach across local authorities? You know, common understanding of net zero, common understanding about how targets should be applied. Could I ask perhaps Gail to go first, please, on that one? From a COSLA perspective?
Yeah, I think it's... Thank you very much for the question. I think it's also from an individual local council perspective. At the moment, as we are, as we've already said, collaboration and that more unified approach is required. And that needs to be done in conjunction, obviously, with Scottish Government. We have a lot of targets to reach. We have a lot of initiatives and policies coming through from Scottish Government. But it's then how it is developed and delivered at local level. And you will see some differences and disparities between individual councils. That's absolutely right and proper. They should be able to develop initiatives that work for their own local areas. There's been some criticism of some councils for not even having an environment committee. And again, I think that comes down to localism, because there's a lot of councils who are simply embedding the climate change agenda and the net zero agenda across their entire operations. So it almost doesn't require an individual committee to do that. It's the responsibility of every committee and every department within the council to embed and intertwine our net zero targets into all of the work we do across councils. But I think an awful lot of it comes from ring fence funding, individual policies that maybe don't suit a particular area, and then that local council has to modify and adapt that to suit the locality. So really, you know, going back to resource again, it's not all about the amount of money we're getting, it's how that money can be used flexibly. And again, you know, we do have a challenge of attracting skilled people into our councils, whether it be through planning or economic development, or people who are filled up on climate change agenda. There is a recruitment issue across Scotland, and I think until we address that, it is going to leave us slightly on the back foot, but not without the will to do better and do more.
Yeah, but within your working group within COSLA, Gail, I mean, is there political unanimity behind having a more consistent approach, say, around targets. So obviously there's all those issues around, you know, how best to deliver those targets and different size of local authorities and everything else.
Yeah.
But is there, would there be political unanimity in your working group around making things more consistent in terms of the way that targets are set and targets are planned for?
I'll maybe turn to Silke in a moment, because obviously she's been doing the work with the officers across councils on the targets and reporting and scrutiny and the such like. From the political end, council leaders, all 32 council leaders, are absolutely signed up to this agenda and progressing. But leaders will always work on the basis that local, individual, bespoke initiatives are required. So while we're signed up to the wholesale net zero agenda and the targets of 2030 and 2045, I think leaders would recognise that within that there does have to be a bit of flexibility, and it cannot be a one-size-fits-all. That simply is not going to work for Scotland or for our communities.
Right. Could I turn to Silke then, just to add to that?
Thank you very much, Convener. Yes, absolutely agreeing with Councillor McGregor here. I guess in response to that question, I just wanted to highlight, having listened into the earlier session, so there are certain very clear standards. The public sector reporting duty applies to all councils and actually the wider public sector. And it's very consistent in a way emissions are being reported here. They are very clearly reported for each council, for their own emissions, for their own properties and workings. You will find in the first reports that are going to be coming in sort of like later this year on the public sector reporting duty that each council will report on its targets and will start to explain how it's aligning budget. So this is something that is just running in as we speak. And clearly we have to a little bit find our way here, because the last thing we want to do in a climate emergency essentially is to spend most of our time sort of like figuring out, you know, the right ways of aligning the reporting between councils. What is absolutely on the forefront for individual authorities, knowing that we need to make rapid progress, is that each council needs to know where they can have the biggest impact with the limited resources they have. And that is quite different across Scotland. So there are councils clearly sort of like, you know, in very rural settings where a lot of the work in the agricultural sector is really key, which is totally different. Glasgow or Edinburgh, for example. So I would say there's an absolutely clear commitment from the politicians within COSLA to put all their weight behind it. There are certain base data which are the same across all local authorities, and there are certain data in terms of going more wider, in terms of going into the placemaking, the political influence in the geographical areas where we're finding our feet and where we need to work closely between the local authorities, but also very good with Scottish Government. We need to have, yeah, you know, a constructive dialogue here. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. And David, I mean, turning to council officers then, I mean, do you think there's a need for more of a framework around how plans are developed for tackling climate change, around how targets are set?
Thanks, Mr. Ruscoe. I think as Silke has pointed out, we have, and I'm sure George, if there's time, would like to come in on this, through the Sustainable Scotland Network, coordinate and administer the public sector climate change reporting duty. We have, I think, quite a clear framework in terms of how we capture emissions activity within the public sector. There is also, as Silke outlined, target setting requirement around that new for this year as part of the November round. So I think we have that framework in place. I think most authorities, and again, tuning into the last session, the Thames Commission report around how things are operating in the space within local government noted that there are most authorities now have target in place, and that varies. And what we need to become a bit more obsessed about actually going to be delivering those targets, because I think we're clear on where we need to go, that we need to focus on buildings, we need to focus on fleet, and we need to focus on food. And the government, and the local government, that is, has a clear agenda in terms of you know, influencing that directly and indirectly. So I think we're getting there in terms of target setting, in terms of how data is collated. Also, we had the Solace conference in Edinburgh just last week, where the leaders' checklist was introduced. And again, George may want to talk a bit more about that, which is a sort of self-assessment tool for local authorities who, you know, have been working in the space since the introduction of the Climate Change Act more than 10 years ago now. Most local authorities have made some inroads, so it's about how we galvanise and how we bring scale and pace to that, which touches on some of the themes that are around resources and some of the other aspects that, that Silky listed off earlier.
Yeah. Yeah. George, do you want to add to this point?
Yeah, very much so. Certainly would agree with my colleagues on the panel in terms of the focus on a consistent approach. I'm more than happy to send the SSN strategy onto the committee. That's essentially what our members asked us to do, which was try and bring a lot of the complexity in this agenda into more sort of consistent approaches. That's easier said than done, as you can imagine, but that's the direction of travel that the SSN is trying to pursue. I think related to that, though, in order to get consistency, we need stability, because a lot of our members out there, they are sort of doing things in a more consistent manner. They're working to professional standards that are coming from the international protocols. So you've got greenhouse gas protocols that are becoming more robust and more well understood and more actively applied. So it's less inconsistent than what you're probably imagining, but there's certainly more work to be done here. And I think one thing that would help our members is just a sort of stability and a strategic intent within the public bodies, within local government, to sort of build, you know, build that consistent approach. Because if there's a lot of shifting about in terms of is it a priority, what's the focus, etc., that gets in the way of sort of building that consistent approach. And it is really a process of professionalisation. So again, the SSN sort of playing into that space, but there's, as you've heard from the previous panel and you're hearing from ourselves, so much more work to be done, especially as we embed this across different professions within local government. Myself, with the team in SSN and the Secretariat, plus also colleagues in the Edinburgh Climate Change Institute, we've been doing some work in this area, especially in the area-wide emissions space, looking at could we build capacity in terms of more efficient and effective approaches to data, to tools, and to capacity building. So that, you know, we know where we need to go in terms of a consistent approach, in terms of those professional protocols that need to be applied. It's how do we actually build the resource in Scotland? It does need investment, but we just need to do it in a smart, joined up way. And I think it very much lends itself to a classic sort of shared service approach in Scotland. And I think SSN itself has huge convening power in that space. The SSN steering group itself brings together the local government, brings together the various representative bodies like COSLA and SOLAS, but also brings in the wider public sector. So there's a lot of interest in this space here from the enterprise agencies that are looking at this through, you know, can we get the collaboration accelerated so we can make this an investable proposition at a place level? Mm-hmm. So yeah, there's a range of things that we can do in this space. The last thing I would say is, there's been a lot of conversation today about targets, and I think we've got a concern about, you know, you can overly obsess about targets, and especially when you get into the space around the wider influence that local authorities and the partners have in terms of using the procurement to drive action and to really take a role in terms of local governance. It's harder to play targets into that equation. So again, in the SSN strategy, you'll see we talk about corporate emissions, where local authorities have very tight control over their own emissions. But then they've got the supply chain influence, and then they've got the role around place. And the further you go into that, it has bigger impact, but you have less direct control. So I think targets, we need to be very, you know, cautious about how we focus on targets. And in many ways, the focus really needs to be on, do you have a plan to achieve your targets? And can you get the investment in place in terms of finance and people to get the projects underway and actually make the steps towards the targets?
Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you, Mark, and thanks for those contributions. Could I just be mindful that I've got a lot of committee members to try and keep happy on my first day convening this committee, and so short answers to their very short questions would help me to achieve that. And I'm going to go to Jackie next, because I think yours are the next questions that I've put on my list.
Thank you, Convener. I'll be very quick. I'm going to ask the same question as I asked the last panel, but I'd be interested in hearing your take on the answers. And that was, how have councils responded to statutory emissions reporting requirements? Are these gaps, do you think, are there gaps in calculating and reporting on emissions? And what role might COSLA and SOLAS have in addressing these? If I can go to Councillor McGregor first, please.
Thank you. I think in the spirit of not using up too much time, it might be better if one of the officers answer this question.
Oh, even better. Who would you suggest, Councillor McGregor?
I suspect that Silke would probably be very on the ball with this.
OK.
Thank you very much, Gail. Thank you, Convener. I think, again, in the shortness of time, I think what our response here is that we are keen to develop the public sector data reporting away from just the emissions of every council into the wider influence sphere. So these are the geographical emissions that have been discussed here. But what we need to do is to do that in such a way that we're not tying all our resources down in finding the perfect reporting mechanism and not leaving enough resources to do other important work, which is, I think, the other point that was made here.
OK, David, would you have anything to add?
Thanks, Ms. Dunbar. I think for me, again, in the spirit of brevity, in terms of gaps, I think it would be fair to say across the sort of local government family, Scope 3 emissions is an area where a number of local authorities are still getting to grips with their impact on that area. But again, through support that's provided by George and his team via SSN, the climate change reporting duty, that's enough that we are starting to crack. But overall, really, it's about resource in terms of collation and analysis of the data that we gather.
Okay, thank you. Back to you, Convener.
You're going to be my friend for life if you're as short as that, Jackie. Thank you very much. Liam, I think you've got some questions you'd like to ask.
Yes, please. Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. David Hammond, I'll throw a question to you first, which I'll put to Gail McGregor afterwards. But, David, you quoted the COSLA submission earlier on around the financial pressures facing local authorities. What you picked up was the quote, net zero has a price tag which is not currently being met. So, similar question to the one I asked the earlier panel, what will the impact of the public pay settlements, the recent Scottish Government spending cuts, and of course inflationary pressures have on local authorities' ability to deliver on their net zero ambitions? And given what we heard earlier, and the submission says a lack of flexibility of funding, what can be done?
Thank you, Mr. Kerr, for that question. I think it cuts really to the heart of the matter, and we recognise, as Silke said earlier, that there are no easy answers and that no tier of government has the funding available, and we're going to have to work really creatively, particularly with the private sector. So in terms of that price tag, as we put it, that it comes with net zero, we need to look at economies of scale, in my view, across local government in terms of buildings and fleet in particular. So while some of the solutions locally may differ, we have common challenges across local authority in terms of decarbonising heat in our buildings and electrifying or finding other alternative fuels such as hydrogen for our fleet. And we need to work together and collaborate, including with the help of SSN, and maybe working more closely between local government and Scottish Government in terms of funding that is available and programmes that are available, and what the criteria for those are, and to keep them as flexible as possible, so that we can start to move into a space where we are working collaboratively to create investable business cases for some of the retrofit that's required for buildings and for investment in charging infrastructure for electric vehicles, etc. So, in summary, I think we need to be really creative and work with the private sector. And I would suggest perhaps that Scottish Futures Trust is a potential vehicle to help broker some of those discussions that are required. Thank you.
Very grateful. Gail McGregor, do you have any thoughts?
Thanks, Liam. I'll not repeat what David said. I think finance is very complex, as you're aware. Currently, about 30% of our budget is the part of the budget that we can take savings from. The almost 70% of councils' budgets is essentially ring-fenced or protected, which makes it very difficult for councils to wire additional funding into things that have not been seen as priorities until fairly recently. So, as an example, we see lots of funding coming in through bid funds, which makes it very difficult for some councils who maybe don't have the capacity in what I call the back room, due to successive years of cuts to, you know, our economic development departments and planning departments. So we then have some councils disenfranchised because they don't have the skills and capacity to bid into those funds. Now, if we have much more flexibility around that funding, with an ability to utilise that funding locally in the way that we see fit, as I said earlier on, that would be incredibly helpful. We do have some very high overarching sort of target-driven policies, which is absolutely brilliant, but then we have to develop the how we deliver those particular targets. And again, without sufficient resource and skills within those areas, it's going to become more and more challenging as we go further and further down the line. So I think at the moment what we need to see is that any funding that is coming into councils has as much flexibility as possible, and particularly where capital funding is required, that we then have ongoing resource funding to ensure that we can then, you know, maintain whichever capital investment we've had, because historically we end up with big pots of capital funding but no resource funding to ensure that we can continue to maintain that. So I think that's probably the biggest challenge that we have at the moment, is flexibility around funding. But we also need some very, very clear targets from Scottish Government and Scottish Parliament to ensure that we are all sort of working together as we should be.
I'm very grateful. Silke Isbrand, taking Gail's comments there, if you would, and I'm throwing this to you because of something you said earlier. COSLA has argued in favour of fewer but larger and more flexible funding streams to support place-based net zero initiatives. What precisely does COSLA mean by that in practice? And in your view, what specific aspects need to change? So is it the specific ring fencing? Is it the non-domestic rate setting? Is it more council tax freedom? What is it?
What it is exactly what Gail has highlighted here in terms of the multitude of small challenge funds we find ourselves with. So a lot of the Scottish Government funding that comes towards local authority comes for specific measures within heat decarbonisation, or specific measures within transport, or specific measures to increase recycling rates and decarbonise waste management. So this is the situation we're finding ourselves within at the moment. So that has got a number of implications, as David and Councillor McGregor have outlined. It reduces local government's flexibility to use these funds, to lever in funds from outside. That's one implication of this. The second thing is that these multitude of challenge funds which are being balanced by officers within individual councils do not really allow for the effective strategic planning for interventions. So where a council finds itself that it has found that an intervention in X, Y and Z would be the most effective way, it can't just sort of like plan for a number of years ahead in these areas. and it is also harder to harness the co-benefits, which are, of course, so, so, so important here, because we're not just only talking about net zero, we're also talking about a just transition. We're also talking about of having that transition in a way where we protect the biodiversity and so on and so on. So co-benefits, we might be missing a lot of co-benefits that we would otherwise, if the same amount of money came to us but in a different way, could bring in much more, i.e. we would have higher output. I think the other thing is that challenge funds in themselves are very cost ineffective. The amount of staff time that is not just required within local authorities, and Gail sort of like highlighted, not every small local authorities can use what might be on the table here, but it is not cost effective in terms of the officer time in local authorities that are applying for these, and in other organisations, be it Scottish Government or other administering bodies, who are then overseeing the Challenge Fund, who are then assessing bids, who are then, you know, keeping track of this progress. So these are areas where the existing money could be used in a much more effective way, over and above the argument that we've made with regard to the level of funding.
I'm very grateful. Unless anyone else wishes to contribute, I'll hand back to the convener.
Thank you very much, Liam. I'm going to come to the deputy convener now for some questions you've got.
Okay, thank you. Good afternoon. I'd like to talk about the collaboration and coordination, and to ask first Councillor Gail McGregor, what do we need to do to get that better collaboration and coordination between local and central government? And we've had evidence from Louise Merrick-Evans, written evidence, that local, this is across the UK, she's saying that there needs to be between local government and different levels of government, some kind of framework agreement, some kind of framework mechanism. Do you think that's needed, or do you think there's sufficient coordination and collaboration already happening?
Thank you, Deputy Convener. I think we've touched on the services slightly, but for me, collaboration and coordination is key. But it's not just between local government and Scottish Government, it has to be between us, Scottish Government and UK Government, our communities, businesses, private enterprise. This is a massive, massive issue that is going to affect everybody. And I think the key thing that we need to be doing as local authorities, particularly given that we are closest to the people that we serve, is ensuring that we're taking our communities with us as well, and ensuring that our communities understand what our direction of travel is. And I think at the moment, none of us are doing that particularly well. I think local government and Scottish Government need to have a much clearer plan, which is co-produced and jointly produced, with very clear markers over the next few years as to what we're trying to achieve. And then, obviously, we can look at resource for that. But what we also need to be doing is ensuring that our communities understand that they are signed up to it, that they're not just suddenly seeing umpteen electric charging points in their communities, they weren't consulted on it, they don't understand why they're in that place. So collaboration has to go wider than just local government and Scottish Government. I think this is just too big an issue for it not to. So yes, the framework would be useful, but I think what we do get into a bit of a trend over the years of doing is that Scottish Government announces something and then we're expected to deliver it. And actually, if we have really good co-production of policies together, I think we get a much better outcome. So my plea to Scottish Government would be, through their various ministers, and I've met with a few already, that we have a much more defined plan collectively, and that the UK Government obviously has to play its part in that as well, and as I say, communities. So yes, more collaboration and coordination, but it has to be meaningful and it has to be done in the co-production.
So the written evidence from COSLA calls for a mechanism to be developed, and I quote, by which we can better manage the multiple decarbonisation challenges that we face and their impact on the economy and society. So we all know it needs to happen. So what we want to know is, what do you think it would look like in practice, rather than say we need to do this?
Yeah, well, Deputy Convener, you'll appreciate I'm about 2 months into this role, so I'm getting my head around the various massive issues within this. We do have a good relationship with government, and I think it will involve some more dialogue between myself and my team and the ministers as to how we progress that. Obviously, we're very happy to take anything to cause the leaders at any point to get a mandate from them if required. But we do need to do this at pace. Silke might be able to add a bit more as to what discussions have happened between officers and in that officer space and civil service space.
Yeah.
But certainly now that I've got the bit between my teeth with this, I will keep running with it until I'm told to stop.
Oh, thank you very much. And Kirsten McGregor, I appreciate that you've only been 2 months in post, but our committee is about to report. We're coming to the end of our session. So if there's something yes. useful that you want us to include in that report, it would be helpful to know what that mechanism would look like. So, Silke, do you want to come yeah. in then at the invitation of Kirsten McGregor?
Yes, just very quickly, and in answer to your question, what would that mean? I think the co-production is really the key word here. Co-production, not just of intervention, but also of policy, because every policy that is being co-produced is going to be more likely to be more effective. And what we don't have at the moment at all is any joint oversight between the two spheres of government of the climate change plan, climate change plan, the delivery frameworks, and so on. So there are huge opportunities which can be harnessed here.
And can I come to David Hammond and your view on this? Is you talked about there being a lot of collaboration already between officials, but I wonder if there's anything else that you think is needed to provide that co-production or the mechanism, because yes, everybody needs to be involved, private sector, local government, national government, but should it be done on a place basis? Is there a role for city deals here? How do we actually put this into practice?
Thank you, Deputy Convener. I think as my colleagues, Councillor McGregor and Stoker, have got a deal covered. I think there is potential to look at a kind of framework agreement. In my own view, we need some structure around this in terms of clarifying roles and responsibilities between Scottish Government, local government and the other actors in this space. I think at the moment it is quite a crowded marketplace and there is a lot of duplication potentially and overlap, and what we want to try and do is clear the way through that and then identify where the synergies are. And I think the point that Councillor McGregor made just around co-production is a really important one. So I think local government would welcome closer and earlier conversations with Scottish Government colleagues around particularly building and fleet challenges and the roles and opportunities for local government to deliver on those agendas, but also to be clear on what local government isn't responsible for in the areas where we have less influence. That's important to be clear about as well, you know, in terms of industrial emissions, for example. Hopefully that's helpful.
And can I just finally just ask, is there a tension between local government delivering net zero for its own estate and its own responsibilities, but also taking leadership on a place-based approach, which perhaps touches on the point that industrial emissions clearly are not the immediate public sector side, but if a place-based solution would require you to have some kind of remit or responsibility in that area or not?
And I think, Deputy Convener, this is where data is really important and taking an area-based approach so that local government as the kind of leaders locally in terms of carbon emissions and climate change are clear on those sorts of emissions in their area. They're clear on where they provide leadership. They're clear on where they have directed on the state, as you said, and they're clear on where they can support and partner with other areas, but they're also clear on where there is perhaps less influence and less of a remit, so that roles and responsibilities of others that then come into play for example, industrial partners, how they can work together. And indeed, the synergies point that I made in terms of maybe where we start to get creative and work in spaces in local government that we haven't worked in previously, about taking that area-based approach and understanding the source of emissions. And I've talked before at this committee around, for example, public sector renewable energy generation, where a number of authorities now are coming forward with major renewable energy generation proposals and meet stumbling blocks in terms of grid capacity, grid connection, timescales and process, and we can work creatively to unlock some of those and perhaps partner with major power off-takers to help decarbonise their energy requirements as well.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So, Thank you very much. I think Natalie Don's going to lead some questions now for the committee. Natalie.
Thank you, convener, and welcome to the panel. So I just want to focus on around the idea of community again. So written evidence from COSLA called for sustainable and scalable community empowerment support, and we heard from the last panel how important that community empowerment will be. I'm just wondering if you could give more information on what that support will look like in practice. And I'll go first to Silke, please.
Sorry, can you hear me? Yes, I think it builds very much on what Councillor McGregor has talked about in terms of linking into the local communities and really sort of like exploiting is a horrible word, using, maximising the potential that is there. I mean, one thing we're really, really clear about is that behaviour change is such a key aspect. It's the one thing that's perhaps the most cost-effective intervention that can be done, and there's a lot more that can be done here. Local communities, interacting with local communities as the backbone for a behaviour change, for an understanding of the implications of not sort of like adapting carbon reducing behaviour is absolutely critical here. And then it leads into these sort of like, you know, projects that can be done that David Hammond sort of like elaborated on. But it's pretty clear all across the board, be it transport, be it waste, be it whatever, that there's a lot here still to be done, and that there's a path to be driven, and that can't just be done by individual councils, but that needs to be, you know, across and in tandem with Scottish Government, that people understand that carbon reduction behaviour is as much expected as we're putting on our seatbelts, and that we're not, you know, drink driving anymore. It's that level of understanding. And that, again, needs to be underpinned with data, with research, so that that every citizen can understand what their own consumer choices actually have as a consequence.
Absolutely. I mean, local authorities are best placed, to know their communities. And we heard from the last panel that some of the challenges are focused around finance, which we've discussed today, but also around education and raising awareness, which is what you've just alluded to. So is there anything else that you think is important to know in terms of the challenges and opportunities for communities? And in which sectors do you feel that there are opportunities for innovation, learning and partnership between communities and local authorities? I'll go back to you, Silke, but I'll move on to Councillor McGregor after you, please.
Yeah, I'll just be very swift. I don't think we can pin it down to any area. I mean, I think we've seen with some of the example Dundee was highlighted here, you know, what actually can be done by different local authorities and what they focus on, again, whether they focus on agriculture or, you know, greenbelt, you know, tree planting or the local industry will be very, very different where the biggest opportunities are. So I think it is there across the board. Local authorities have got the best knowledge what, again, the biggest bang, the biggest issue, the biggest thing that on people's hearts are in their local area. What is absolutely important for local authorities is to have the capacity to actually invest in this work with local communities so that we can underpin the transition on net zero with that firm, you know, with that firm commitment of the local communities.
Thank you very much. And if I could move on to Councillor McGregor, and it's really just a similar point. Although obviously, as I asked in the last panel, so I'll ask in this one too, we're obviously policymakers at different levels, and it's just what do you think that we as policymakers can do to reduce the barriers between the sort of community empowerment?
Thanks very much, Natalie. A really good question. Communities have to be at the heart of this, and I think we've found, we will all have found as elected members, that if we have a good policy, such as a zero waste policy or a recycling policy within our communities, that's well expressed and conveyed to the communities and done in consultation with them, it works. It just doesn't work when we don't have that level of community engagement, and then we get kicked back and we get the bad headlines. So there's so much that does need to be done in terms of energy reduction and efficiency, renewable energy projects, community groups that are maybe trying to achieve carbon neutral status, that all of that work can be done very easily by us because we are closest to our communities. There's absolutely no question of that. I think as lawmakers, from your side, we come across hurdles that don't always involve resource. So sometimes we find hurdles within planning. That isn't necessarily because we don't have sufficient funding within that department, or it's more likely that we don't have enough that are skilled to assist. So what could you be doing as lawmakers to perhaps ease some of the planning processes and the regulations that can become a bit of a barrier for community groups or councils or individual households or businesses to improve and to play their part within that? So I suppose it's looking back into the Scottish Parliament and saying, we're all on this journey together, we've all got to move together, but what can you do as lawmakers just to relax or ease some of the regulation that we do actually find quite bureaucratic and difficult at local level? So I suppose that would probably be one example, but I think the key thing for us is to communicate well with business and industry, private sector as well. We have a wealth of partners across Federation of Small Businesses, Chambers of Commerce, we have enterprise agencies across Scotland. We have good models within the city growth deals and the rural growth deals. So we have precedent of how we can look for projects within communities that can add value. But all of that takes time and resource. And ultimately, as I say, needs to be done sort of on a co-production basis to ensure that we're all moving in the same direction.
All right, thank you. I'm happy to pass back to the convener. Thanks.
Thanks, Natalie. And colleagues, just in case, when it comes to David Hammond speaking, I'm afraid in order to preserve the sound quality, we have removed his picture, but he's still very much there, I'm sure, wanting to answer questions. But I'm going to come to the next lot of questions, which comes from, I think it's Monica. I think you're on next, are you not?
Thank you, convener. I have one question on the issue of procurement. So we talked about it a little bit in the last session, but time ran out. So I'm keen to just go around all our witnesses to hear if they have any examples or views on how procurement is being used by local authorities to further the net zero goals, and if there's any views on whether local authority procurement rules allow for a focus on carbon savings, and if there's time, maybe if someone can touch on how this is helping local economies and small business as well. So I'm not sure who's best to go first. Councillor McGregor is waving, so I'll come to Councillor McGregor, and then perhaps Silky, and then David, and then George.
Thanks very much, Monica. Procurement's a difficult issue across 32 councils, because again, it's all very different, and Scotland itself certainly assists with that. I think the key thing with procurement is, as we're working through things like the Community Wealth Building Bill, that we embed within the procurement processes within that bill and the work that we're doing with Mr. Arthur around ensuring that any procurement is mindful of decarbonisation and net zero targets, and making it straightforward for local authorities to embed that within our processes. And as I said earlier on, not every council has an environment committee, and that's because many are working on the basis that absolutely every single piece of work that we do or we bring through every department has to be looking at our contribution to decarbonisation and net zero. So I think procurement is incredibly important around that, particularly in respect of food, for instance, where our food is coming from, where our materials are coming from, buying local as far as possible. So the regulations around procurement will probably filter through on a sort of just transition and a net zero basis, the Community Wealth Building Bill. But we can be doing things before that, the stuff that we can do without it being implicit within another bill.
That's helpful, Councillor McGregor. I'm pleased you mentioned community wealth building. Perhaps David can maybe add to that. I know from a North Ayrshire experience, he might have further thoughts on that. I'll come next to Silky, and then David after that. Or unless we have David now.
Oh, I think you're confusing everyone. You're David, you're on.
Yeah, hopefully everyone can hear me a bit better. And
much better.
My camera's been switched off. It's not a different way of telling me that I've got a face for a radio, which wouldn't be the first time, but I'm sure that's not the case.
Just picking up on Ms. Lennon's points around procurement, I think I want to touch briefly back on what I talked about earlier in terms of the need for economies of scale and for cross-authority and cross-government collaboration, particularly around buildings and fleet, those being the two biggest areas of emission that we need to tackle. So it's about how we kind of bundle up for me in terms of the solutions that we're procuring to bring those economies of scale to create business cases that are more investable. And to give the committee a quick example of that, the three Ayrshire authorities, North, where I work, and East and South, are working collaboratively on a Pathfinder exercise brokered. Can everyone still hear me okay? I'm just getting a message up on my screen.
David, I can tell you that we can hear you much more clearly than we've heard during the rest of the meeting. So plug on, you're doing well and we're hearing well.
Yeah, that's... Apologies, there was just an error message popped up there. So we're working collaboratively with the other two Ayrshire authorities to look at EV charging infrastructure. And that's a Pathfinder exercise that's been brokered by Scottish Futures Trust. And I won't go into detail here, but suffice to say, we very quickly established the number of chargers, the level of investment required, where those chargers need to go, and the role of the private sector in terms of pulling together a financial model. So, Ms Lennon, there's an opportunity that, we've managed to make some progress on very quickly, and we're coming up with an that we can then procure collaboratively across the Ayrshires. And that, for me, is something that we need to see more of and do more of in the other sectors that we need to tackle. And lastly, and very quickly, around procurement rules, which was part of your question, we have been engaging with Scottish Procurement to try and find ways around the current contracts that we have through the Crown Commercial Services Framework for buying power, where that's been a real barrier for us in terms of our renewable energy generation proposals. We want to undertake what's known as sleeving, and without getting into the technicalities, basically the current contractual arrangements of how we buy power nationally across the sector of state doesn't allow for that. And I think we would urge consideration of these types of major contracts that are re-tendered regularly to ensure that they're fit for purpose and that they are enabling the creativity that's required for different solutions in order to reduce our carbon emissions. And that's a big part of, I think, the procurement journey that we need to go on. So thank you, Convener.
Thank you. And just to build on David's answer, Silke, I wonder if you could maybe say something from a causal point of view about how we sort of roll out good practice. So we've heard some examples here from David. How do we make sure that learning doesn't just sit within Ayrshire, for example, and we can learn Scotland-wide?
Yeah, thank you. I think this goes back to our point in terms of needing that local government needs more capacity to actually put in the structures or make the existing structures sort of like, not make them more effective. Sorry, I'm rambling a bit here, but I think it was put forward before that we've got very good groundwork in place, but that we still need resources to actually develop some of the work areas here. So we have, for example, within the SSN community, we've looked at procurement tools that could allow local authorities to assess quite rapidly, which of their local providers or which of their providers generally, would offer most sort of like products with the best carbon savings and so on. So it's very much about what we're talking about in terms of the tools that we need to further develop and that the resource that we need to have in place to develop these tools. And then we can pick up either best practice from individual authorities and weave these into tools, or develop tools, share and develop tools between local authorities so that we essentially increase that capacity.
Thank you very much. And finally to George.
Yep, thanks very much. A couple of things just to add to what's been said so far. I think there's been really good work done by the Scottish Government over the last couple of years, just pulling a lot of the rules and tools together into one space so that people can find them and access them more rapidly. So you're there on the Scottish Government's website now. We can point practitioners towards it. The only thing I would really add is we used to do an awful lot more work in the procurement space, bringing together procurement professionals and sustainability or climate change professionals in the public sector so they could understand each other's agendas, ways of working, etc. A lot of this is less a procurement challenge, it's more a specification issue. You know, who's actually determining what the authority decides to buy, how it buys, and then how it plays its procurement into meeting those objectives. And we're all moving, trying to push towards sort of procurement to achieve outcomes. So really, I would just sort of say we could do far more in the space in terms of training and capacity building. We just need to be given the means to do that. We've got very good sort of connections across the public sector and with Scottish Government in this space. It just needs that acceleration and amplification.
Thank you. It's a very clear answer. Thank you, George.
Monica, if you're finished, I'm going to come to the Deputy Convener, who's got an interesting point on finance.
Thank you. We're interested in how we leverage in more private finance or support from private business to that place-based solution for net zero. So I can maybe if I can come to Silke, if you could maybe address that issue. Some councils like Glasgow, we've heard, are already doing a great deal of this. What are the barriers and opportunities for all councils to be able to leverage in private investment, but also how do we do it in such a way that councils aren't carrying all the risk in terms of that, because that's a concern we've heard of as well.
Yeah, thank you Deputy Convener. I won't comment on the risk and leave that one to others. How do we enable that? It basically comes back to the simple answer of the flexibility of the finance. You know, having good resources available where we know that they come over a number of years that councils can use to lever in, you know, to shape around those opportunities for bringing in other public sector finance or other private sector finance as and where there are opportunities, rather than having to stitch together, you know, three different programs which all don't really match with each other. I think that's a principal point around that, the flexibility of the funding so that it can be used in a strategic way to lever in other funding. But I leave the risk element to others.
And can I maybe ask David Hammond if he wants to address this same question, but also addressed, does he think that council officials have the skills that are required, particularly to embark on those joint venture or different finance mechanisms that can be used, and what's needed to help share that skill base across local authorities?
Thank you, Deputy Convener. I think for me, in terms of that leveraging in private sector investment, we need solutions of scale, so that the scale of what we are procuring is of sufficient interest to the private sector. I think there has to be a return there, a commercial return, in order for the private sector to be interested and want to invest in financing that, partnering with us. And as you rightly said, Deputy Convener, we need to have a clear understanding of risk. And I think we need to be risk aware within the public sector, not necessarily risk averse, because the scale of the challenge, quite frankly, in my opinion. I think we do have some tried and tested methods. For example, there was the NDEE, which is non-domestic energy efficiency projects, a wave of those. My own authority participated in that, where it was a set contract, basically, around how energy efficiency measures were installed in public buildings. So a suite of buildings, a suite of measures, a price tag for those, and guarantees in terms of the reductions and cost savings that were provided that helped then finance the investment that was required, but there was an element of private finance in those as well. So I think I've mentioned already, I do see Scottish Futures Trust as a potential vehicle where that has been successful in other areas. For example, the electric vehicle charging project that I mentioned that we are involved in. And I think they have skills and knowledge in this area that might fill some of the gaps that you touched on within the public sector in terms of these larger contracts and deals and the complexity that they bring. Thank you.
And can maybe ask Councillor McGregor if she has any views, particularly bearing in mind housing and, if we're taking a place-based approach, private housing and also transport, and that could involve, you know, buses as well as electric vehicle charging, etc. And if we're going to do this at scale, is this a discussion you've embarked on already with the Scottish Government, and how do we get those big mechanisms available for finance at scale, or is that something you think is a definite must for the future?
Some of those conversations have started since I came into the role. I think active travel is a prime example. We know there's a lot of money being committed to that over the term of this Parliament. Now what we need to do is establish what's going to give us the best bang for our buck within our communities, what's absolutely required in terms of active travel, transport initiatives, where they need to be, the differences between rural settings and urban settings, and mapping that significant investment in a way that really, really delivers something for the communities that we're obviously serving. Again, in terms of housing, we have aspiration. We're part of the machine that will enable additional housing, you know, within our communities. But that has to come from a direction, I would say, from government more than from ourselves. We become a partner within that. And it goes back to my point earlier on. Anything that we do in co-production will absolutely deliver a better outcome, whether it be transport, housing, you know, zero waste, all of the agendas that we're signed up to. If we can co-produce those with government and with Parliament and have complete sign-up from all across the Parliament as well, we will get a much better outcome than if we have a diktat, which we then look at and it becomes very difficult to deliver. So active travel is very ambitious. There's a lot of funding behind it, but we need to be creating what our communities need, as well as with an eye to our net zero targets. But as I say, co-production, there's nothing more important than that, I wouldn't have thought.
And on the housing aspect, is COSLA involved in Minister Harvey's Green Finance Task Force that you established on housing?
Yes, and there's a number of schemes. But yeah, absolutely. We haven't met specifically on that particular issue, but I have met Mr Harvey on a broad range of issues. So we'll continue with that agenda as well.
Thank you.
Thank you. Unless there are any other questions, I have just one, if I may, to put to Gail. Having listened to this and read through quite a lot of the reports, it's the scale of the problem that I'm, and the scale of the cost of resolving the issue that I'm struggling to come to terms with. And I take it to a very local place in the Highlands, if I may. There are 873 social houses, 540 of them don't make Ban C. So a surveyor in me tells me that's going to cost between 15 and 40,000 for each house. If it's the top end, it's 21 million. If it's the bottom end, it's about 12 million. My question to you is, if you roll that out across the whole of Highlands, we're probably talking in excess of 150 million just to get the social housing up to 100 to EPCC. So my question is, how do we quantify these policies that are being talked about? And do we know what they're going to cost? Because if we don't know what they're going to cost, are the policies actually going to be valid when they're introduced? And what work have you done with your colleagues on that particular issue?
Thanks very much, Convener. I think you've just highlighted the magnitude and the scale of the issue that we're dealing with. No question that this is probably going to be the biggest one that we deal with in our lifetimes. And I think that we shouldn't be afraid to say that we've not cracked it yet. And it could be a while before we do, and we all need to be doing better. I don't have a specific, and I think David maybe sort of nodded towards this earlier on, a specific cost of what this is actually going to cost, because there's so many things that need to be dealt with. We've discussed active travel, we've discussed zero waste housing. The list is literally endless. And to put a price tag on all of that, I simply don't have that data. Silke might, but it really, really does emphasise the importance of this and the need to, whilst we have targets, then begin to, I suppose, break it down into pieces that we can actually deal with and begin to get to the hows rather than the targets. So we all know within our communities things like your electric charging points, what can be of benefit and can be a short-term fix or hit, but we then have longer-term aspirations. But it is going to cost far more money than local government can cope with, or Scottish Government, possibly even UK Government. And I don't think that we should undersell. It doesn't make us weak. I think, in fact, it probably shows a strength and a confidence that we're acknowledging that this is going to be a massive challenge. But Stilka may have some figures. I very much doubt if we have a global figure, I'm afraid.
I may leave it hanging because EPCs are only three years yeah. away. So if we're going to achieve it in 3 years, I guess we ought to know the cost of it. But I think thank you, and thank you to the other panel members for coming and giving evidence this afternoon, and thank you for rescheduling this meeting to allow you to be here with all that was going on last week. So thank you very much. And that concludes this part of the meeting, which is in public. We're now going to move into private. Thank you.